the injustice.
What I was showing him was this picture here of these statues that were found over in Egypt, Upper Egypt, of black men that were placed there or carved out of solid granite thousands of years ago. And if you notice, he didn't ever turn it toward the camera. He kept it down. Well, I started to turn it toward the camera, but I didn't. I was trying to be polite. And at that point. But today in the Los Angeles Times on page 2, they have this same picture. You look in today's Los Angeles Sunday Times, and they have a story on page 2 about this temple over in Africa. They call it Egypt, but Egypt is in Africa. And the value of which is so tremendous, it points out how the United Nations is trying to float a loan of around $30 million to save this temple from being covered by the waters that will be brought up by this Aswan Dam that they're trying to build over there. And this thing is so shrewdly done that the average Negro will look at it and read it, and because it says Egypt, he never identifies it with him or him with it. It shows you how shrewd the white man is. But when all you have to do is look at the features of the thing, and you can see, brother, they got all the features that the white man says Negroes have. But because it is associated or connected with something of such value, archaeological and historic anthropological value, the white man tries to steal it for himself and says, no, these are white people, these aren't black people. And look at this for yourself. Look closely at it, and then, and if you notice, you'll also read in there where the United States is on record as being against putting out the money necessary to save this archaeological wonder. They're against it. And it tells you in the paper that they're against it. They want to let it go on and go beneath the waves. There was a time when America would be for preserving something like that. Because in those days, the black man was so dead mentally, he could look right at it and wouldn't know he was looking at himself. He looked right at it and wouldn't know he was looking at himself. And today, when we see a black man, we know that's a black man, whether they call him an Egyptian, a re-Egyptian, or an Egyptian. Don't care what they call him. All you got, if he look like you, he's the same thing as you. And this man that they have here, brothers and sisters, it has nothing but the features of a pure black man. Also, they tell me that there's an exhibition going on in Los Angeles right now somewhere about King Tut. Where is that? Some kind of museum. Where is it? Exposition. Where is it? Oh, Exposition Park. I saw King Tut's mummy, tomb, when I was in Egypt. And I don't know if they have the same one here, but if you go and see it, you'll find out that this King Tut, whose mummy or sarcophagus, whatever they call it, they have, it's as black as this board. And the white man knows this. Every picture that they have of King Tut, he's not brown. No, he is black, brother, just like this. And the black people who lived in that day had mastered science to such extent, had mastered chemistry to such extent that they could create colors that the dye hasn't faded to this day. Now, you know this, the white man got to paint his house every year. You got to paint yours, inside and out. You haven't got a piece of cloth at home that won't fade if you put it in the sun. But yet these black people back there could make dye that has retained the color, same grade quality, right down to the day from 5,000 and 6,000 years ago. They were master chemists. And this tomb, and I guess mummy, is gold encrusted. They had so much gold back then. In fact, those were the people who discovered gold. They knew what gold was. White man didn't know what gold was. And they encrusted their mummies with gold and beautiful colors and just laid them there. And finally, when the white man discovered them, he was shook up and wondered, how could these people back so long ago, supposed to be dumb, know so much about so many things that he doesn't know about today? Usually when he projects these findings, these wonders, these relics from the past, when he projects them into this particular society now, our poor, dumb people. Number one, they usually don't go and look at it. You don't find very many Negroes in museums. No, they don't. They go to the ballpark, to the ball game. They don't even go to the zoo. You seldom find Negroes in a museum or in some place where there is something that's going to teach them something. And again, I'm not knocking Negroes saying this. I'm talking to you and me. As Minister John said, there's no strangers here today. We're having a little family chat. And when you have a family chat, you can talk the faults as well as the liabilities as well as the assets. And once you pull out these liabilities, you can correct them. You can go out to any museum and you'll find white people, white women, white mothers, white parents, taking their little children through the museum, showing them this and showing them that. Why, our women don't do that. And because you don't do that, you actually leave a vacuum in the mind of your child. So now, I don't know what this exhibition consists of these Egyptian relics that's on display out here. But as Allah blessed me to see it when I was in Egypt at the Cairo Museum, all of these splendors that belong to that ancient civilization along the Nile that has shocked the white man are relics right out of the past of the black man. And as a rule, you don't have any white man who doesn't know this. He will only contend with you if he thinks that you don't know what you're talking about. But then when the deal goes downhill, if he won't admit that they're outright black, he'll say, well, they got black blood. He's hard for him to admit the full truth, but if you can get him to admit a little bit of truth, the Negro will wake up, because the only truth he accepts is truth that he has come from the lips of the white man. Can you understand this? So I take time to mention that quickly, and you read the Los Angeles Times. I'm not a press agent for the Los Angeles Times, but if it has something in it that's of value, it's good for you and me to go and pick it up and study it for ourselves. And save those kind of things. And then when you're in a discussion with one of these crackers who are trying to bring you and me down, drop it on him. Say, look, boss, what I found in your paper. This man looks just like me. He don't look like you.